From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Welcome to the Copyright Office Roundtables on the Making Available Right. We're going to start off with some brief remarks from Registrar Maria Plante, and then we'll get into the logistics of the actual roundtable discussions today. So I'll turn to Maria for her opening remarks. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. And for those who don't know, that was the indefatigable Karen Temple Claggett, who is the Associate Registrar of Copyrights and Director of Policy and International Affairs. So, a warm welcome to everybody. I know my staff and I are very much looking forward to this discussion. It's an important one. It's not one that we've had for a long time in the United States. I especially want to welcome our panelists who have, well, all of our panelists, but especially those who have come from other cities to join us today. And a very warm welcome to our professors who are here as independent scholars and a very important part of our debate. So as all of you know, but I'll say for the transcript, the Copyright Office is undertaking this study at the request of Congress to assess the state of U.S. law recognizing and protecting making available and communication to the public rights for copyright owners. When the United States implemented the WCT and WPPT, we did so under the permissible umbrella approach, confirming that our exclusive rights under Section 106 taken in combination, adequately protect copyright owners in accordance with the treaty obligations. In the ensuing 15 years, I think we can all agree that the online environment has evolved rapidly. There's no question that some courts have struggled in applying the statute to current technologies and activities. There has been some confusion about the evidence necessary to establish an infringement claim based on the activity of making a copyrighted work available online without authorization. Today, we will explore a number of questions, the degree to which Section 106 continues to adequately cover the rights of making available and communication to the public. For example, do we sufficiently today provide for the actual distribution of a work and the offering of that work for download? And do we provide for the actual transmission of a work to members of the public and the offering of that work for access? We will look at whether and how we should clarify U.S. law to confirm our treaty obligations and the protections that they require. We'll look at how foreign laws have addressed these rights in the past 15 years. And as always, when discussing exclusive rights, we're interested in the application of appropriately tailored limitations and exceptions. My legal staff and I have read all of the public comments and obviously the legislative history and all of the relevant court opinions. We are very thankful for both your focus on the past as well as your concerns about the future. And we welcome the discussion today to the extent possible. We'd like to encourage everybody to speak with as much legal detail as possible, as this is, after all, a complex legal discussion. Thank you very much, and enjoy the day.
Thank you, Maria. Good morning. As Maria mentioned, I am Karen Temple Claggett, Associate Registrar of Copyrights and Director of the Office of Policy and International Affairs. Before we actually begin with our formal sessions, I'd like to go over just a few logistical points for our roundtable discussion today. First, the roundtable sessions will be moderated by us here at the table up front. As you're aware, we're in a House Committee briefing room, and all of the participants are sitting on the raised platform behind us. Participant remarks will be the focus of our discussion today, with guidance and questions from the Copyright Office moderators seated at the front table. We do apologize that our backs will be to the audience because we'll be focused on the participants, and that, as I said, will be the focus of the discussion. Given the number of panelists that we have for each of our four sessions and our desire to hear from all participants, we're going to ask that participants please be mindful of other people speaking and tip your card if you guys are familiar with international negotiations, you know this process very well, but tip your card when you would like to make a comment or ask a question rather than simply jumping in so that we can easily moderate the discussion. We will then formally call on you to signal it is your turn to speak. Otherwise, obviously, things would be very unwieldy very quickly. We also ask that all participants focus your comments and responses to our specific questions that we raised in our NOI or additional follow-up questions that we're going to pose to you today. And given time constraints and the number of panelists that we do have, we do ask that you limit your responses to our questions for each panelist to no more than about 2 to 3 minutes. And I want to reiterate that point. I do apologize profusely in advance, but if you are going over the time, we will unfortunately have to cut you off. So please be very flexible and understanding of our very real time constraints and our need to hear from a broad range of viewpoints. Our final session of the day invites comments from the audience and, time permitting, additional comments from the participants. For the audience, there will be a sign-up sheet available during the lunch break, and comments made in that session will also be limited to 2 minutes. Second, as you can see, today's discussion is being videotaped by the Library of Congress. Participants, hopefully you all received a video release form by email. If you have not signed that, please do so. We need to have those before the end of the session today. For audience members, there will be a short question and answer period, hopefully at the end of each session, in addition to our audience participation session. So if you decide to participate in that question and answer period, you are giving us permission to include your questions or comments in future webcasts and broadcasts of this event. At this time, I'd like to ask everyone in the audience and the participants to please turn off your cell phones or electronic devices that might interfere with the recording of this event. That's actually not our Copyright Office policy, but our friendly ITS policy, just to make sure that they don't have any interference with the videotaping. We also, as you can see, have a court reporter who is transcribing the proceedings. We will not have opening remarks from the participants in the sessions, and the participants already know this, but we will just briefly ask everyone up on the platform to identify themselves by their name and affiliation. If any of the participants or audience members who are not actually participants today have additional comments after the meeting, we definitely have an open door policy in the Copyright Office, so we would be happy to separately meet with you on any of the issues that were raised today. We also may potentially seek additional comments, written comments, to respond to some of the questions and discussions that we have talked about today. If we do so, we'll provide a formal NOI notice. Are there any questions in terms of logistics before we begin the discussions today, either from audience or the participants? Okay, so we'll get started with the first session. I'm just going to read what the first session will discuss, and then I'll sit back at the table to ask some questions. The first roundtable will explore how the exclusive rights in Title 17 cover the making available and communication to the public rights in the context of digital on-demand transmissions, such as peer-to-peer networks, streaming services, and music downloads, as well as more broadly in the digital environment. This session will also address evidentiary issues in infringement actions, and we'll also kind of carry on this discussion for the second section. I'm going to, before we start, introduce or ask my Copyright Office colleagues to introduce themselves briefly, and then we can go around the platform for all of the participants. But I'll start here.
Kevin Amer, Counsel for Policy and International Affairs.
Good morning. Maria Strong, Senior Counsel for Policy and International Affairs.
Jacqueline Charlesworth, General Counsel.
Aaron Watson, Attorney Advisor for Policy and International Affairs. Okay.
Thank you very much. And so now I'm going to ask for everyone on the panel just simply state your name and your affiliation, what if you are here representing an organization or someone else. I'll start with John Biter. And just one other logistical thing, you have to push the button, and the green light will show up if the microphone is on.
So again, my name is John Biter. I'm with the law firm of Shackelford, Zumwalt & Hayes in Nashville, Tennessee, here today representing CSAC, one of the three performing rights organizations.
My name is Andrew Bridges. I'm an internet and copyright litigator in San Francisco and Silicon Valley, speaking on my own behalf.
Thank you.
George Berkowski, Senior Vice President of Litigation and Legal Affairs at the Recording Industry Association of America.
Good morning, I'm Gene Deanna. I'm head of the Recorded Sound Section at the Library of Congress.
Jane Ginsburg, Columbia Law School.
Terry Hart, Director of Legal Policy at the Copyright Alliance.
I'm Glenn Lunny. I'm at Tulane University School of Law.
Peter Minnell, University of California, Berkeley.
Matt Shears, Vice President of Law and Policy at Computer and Communications Industry Association.
I'm Sam Osankis. I'm with ASCAP, the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers.
Nancy Wolf with Cowan, DeBates, Abrams, and Shepard, and I'm here on behalf of, actually, we've modernized, it's PACA, the Digital Media Licensing Association, since images have gone from transparency to files.
Thank you very much, everyone. For our first question, before we actually explore kind of our current state of the law, we wanted to focus a little bit about the past, and specifically the legislative history of Title 17. So we wanted to explore whether the legislative history regarding the evolution of the right of distribution in Section 106(3) of the Copyright Act sheds any light in terms of how we should currently construe U.S. implementations of its international obligations to have a making available right. So generally, what is the role or should be the role of legislative history of the 1976 Act in determining the U.S. implementation of the right of making available? Does our legislative history provide any direct information in terms of the scope of the distribution right under our current law? And I'm actually going to direct, sometimes we'll direct questions, sometimes we will not. This time I'm going to direct a question specifically to Peter Minnell, who already has his flag raised, because I was just reading your Law Review article last night. So I wanted to direct the question to you in terms of any insight about the legislative history of our evolution of the digital distribution or distribution right under our law. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, as you know from the article and from the Copyright Office's work 50 years ago, the terminology in the statute derives from 1960s discussions, probably in rooms like this, involving people like us trying to update a statute, the 1909 statute. And there were many discussions about word choice. And what really struck me as I was reading and teaching about the issues surrounding internet file sharing was why Congress changed the words publish and vend to distribute. Seemed like an interesting question. In fact, the 1961 Register Report used the word publish. And as I discovered in documents that have not gotten a lot of attention, there was a very specific reason. And the article spells that out, but what I want to highlight here is just that judges routinely consider the Copyright Act's legislative history even when the words appear at first blush to be clear. Even common words can have multiple dictionary meanings, as we see whenever we open Webster's. There are several different choices. Many provisions of the 1976 Act were crafted during a largely analog era, and so therefore judges, including, for example, Judge Gertner in the London Sire decision, refers to legislative history in trying to sort these issues out. And so in trying to understand this issue, I peeked behind the curtain. I wanted to see what was going on, and in fact, there are express reasons why they chose the word distribute, and it had nothing to do with narrowing. In fact, the General Counsel of the Copyright Office, Abe Goldman, says the purpose was to broaden. And as Ed Sargoy, the ABA representative, explains, it was largely to avoid confusion that had arisen around publication as a trigger for whether copyright could be forfeited for improper notice. And so that is really what I think the article was trying to do, was to explain that story, which is quite interesting. I'll note that one of the comments by Mr. Standards questions my exploration of legislative history, suggesting that it is improper to consult legislative history predating the enacting Congress. And I'll note merely that the Supreme Court didn't get that message. If you read Kurtzsang, Ticini, CCNV, Aben, Dowling, and Sony, they all refer to pre-legislative session legislative history. In fact, courts will even refer to the Cantu report in interpreting the statute, which is really outside of the legislative bounds. It's about trying to understand these issues. And so that was my purpose, was in exploring that history. Now, I want to note one side piece of research that I did.
Briefly, please. Thanks.
Okay. I came across a brief filed 15 years ago in an important copyright case in which the attorney contended the plain language, of the Copyright Act was clear and governed, and yet proceeded to invoke the statute's legislative history more than 20 times in that brief. I commend that attorney's use of what is suggested is a violation of the cardinal principle of statutory interpretation. And we're fortunate to have that intrepid attorney right here among us. And his name is Andrew Bridges, and the case was RIAA versus Diamond Multimedia. And the only thing I want to add is that the Ninth Circuit referred to that legislative history in correctly construing the statute in favor of Mr. Bridges' client. So the contention that it's improper to look at legislative history is not one that is, I think, respected. I think it's common, and I would say every opinion that's trying to grapple with bringing the analog era Copyright Act into the digital age engages in that process.
Thank you, and I will open it up to others. So is that the answer? Does the legislative history of Title 17 answer the question for us and establish that we do have this broad making available right? And then if anyone wants to comment in terms of the legislative history showing or not showing whether publication or to publish is synonymous with distribution, you can answer that question as well. I'll go to Mr. Bridges, who might want to respond specifically, and then to Mr. Looney.
By the way, the brief at issue there for RIAA versus Diamond Multimedia related to the Audio Home Recording Act of 1992, which contained a statutory provision involving something called a serial copy management system, which the definition of which had been amended out of the statute during the legislative process. And so when you have a statute referring to language that has been amended out before the bill became law, there is a bit of a requirement to look at legislative history. The same issue does not apply to the distribution right. And the statute itself is clear about the fact that the distribution right applies to copies and phono records of a copyrighted work being distributed to the public by sale or other transfer of ownership or by rental, lease, or lending. Now, the concern is the Section 101 of the Copyright Act defines copies and phono records as material objects. The definition is in the statute. So it requires not only a distribution, it requires a distribution of material objects. And it requires not only a distribution of material objects, but it requires a distribution of material objects by sale or other transfer of ownership or rental, lease, or lending. So when that is clear, it may be counterintuitive to people, but it's because these are defined terms. They're defined terms. When it's clear on its face, why go to legislative history to try to vary the clear terms of the statute? And I think that here, I'm going to wrap up briefly. I think this touches on a fundamental question of respect for copyright law in our society. Because when the law says what the law says pretty clearly, but there's a sense that there's a private industry consensus, and we're going to go look at arcane materials and do decades of research to contradict the obvious, it is no wonder that the public believes that copyright law is rigged in favor of certain participants in the process.
Thank you, Mr. Bridges. Before we, I'm sure we might have some responses to your position with respect to whether I think a distribution is a or a download can be constitute a distribution under our Copyright Act. But I want to see first whether there are any responses broadly in terms of the legislative history and specifically with respect to publish, whether publish. Publication is synonymous with distribution, given the legislative history. So I'm going to turn to Mr. Looney, and then I'll let any others who want to respond to Mr. Bridges' point about material objects respond as well.
So just a brief clarification to start. It's Lunny.
Lunny, thank you. Lunny. Sorry.
That's okay. I would add, reiterate Mr. Bridges' point in terms of resorting to legislative history when statutory language is clear. I would also point out that in terms of the legislative history, even if you can equate the distribution with the publication right, it's not all that clear under the 1909 Act that a mere offering of a copy for distribution or lending in a library, for example, would have constituted a publication. Certainly there are no cases where a library was held guilty of copyright infringement or liable for copyright infringement simply by making it available under the 1909 Act. So we don't have a clear definition of production publication in the infringement context where we can use that definition from an infringement case in the 1909 Act to define the scope of the distribution right under the 1976 Act, even if we thought they were meant to be equivalent.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go with Matt and then Mr. Manel.
I think Professor Lonnie said a fair amount of what I was going to say is that if the interpretation of publications offered that is actually sound, we would expect to see like a pre-76 hodling, right? And I'm not aware of any. So until we see a case, you know, that offers that interpretation, I'm not sure I'd put a whole lot of stock in that. Secondly, a further point, and maybe I'm just repeating what Andrew said regarding statutory construction, but it's one thing very much to refer to legislative history to either reinforce the apparent interpretation. You know, I think I'm as guilty as anyone of sort of looking to another sort of source to sort of back up the interpretation that always already appears manifest. It's a very different thing to say this is the language that is clear on its face, the requirement of sale or transfer, and then to resort to the legislative history to reach an outcome that contradicts the language that seems pretty self-evident. Right? So, you know, I think it's a sort of common understanding in law schools that sort of legislative history is sort of our resource of last resort, and that applies with particular force when you're trying to offer an interpretation that is at odds with what we have in the statute.
Thank you, and maybe Mr. Mill, you will have some response to that and whether the legislative history actually contradicts the plain meaning.
Yeah, no, I do. If it was so clear, we'd have a hard time explaining Judge Gertner's decision exactly to the contrary. She comes to exactly the contrary conclusion, and this is in an opinion that Mr. Bridges praises. So I find it rather remarkable that we could call it clear when a district judge who's heard these arguments comes to the conclusion that the legislative history is useful and reaches the exact opposite conclusion. But I want to look back just a week. The Supreme Court rendered a decision interpreting the word extraordinary as it relates to the award of attorney fees under Section 285 of the Patent Act last week in a case called Octane Fitness. Justice Sotomayor wrote for a unanimous court with the caveat that Justice Scalia, and only Justice Scalia, did not join footnotes 1-3. The court ultimately ruled that, quote, its analysis begins and ends with the text of Section 285. So what did those footnotes discuss? The statute's legislative history. Thus, even when the Supreme Court is assessing statutory text that appears clear on its face, 8 of the 9 justices considered appropriate and useful to review legislative history.
Thank you very much. Professor Ginsburg?
I wanted to address the second point about whether a copy has to be a physical object.
Do we have any other comments in terms of the legislative history before we move on to that second point about material objects? Okay, Professor Ginsburg.
I think if you look at 106.3 alone, one might draw that conclusion. But given the number of times that the phrase digital phono record delivery appears in the Copyright Act, a subsequent amendment, and a digital phono record delivery is defined as a digital transmission, and the phrase appears many times in conjunction with the word reproduce and distribute, I think it's pretty clear at this point that the thing that is distributed can be a digital object that is not in a freestanding physical medium.
Great. Mr. Borkowski?
Thank you. Yeah, I was actually going to make that point and a couple of others. If we're talking about not even looking at legislative history, but just talking about the explicit language of the statute, there's a couple of parts of the statute that are interesting. You know, you look at the definition of publication, which says it is the offering to distribute copies or phono records, and then it says publication is distribution of copies or phono records. And then when you look at section 115, which Professor Ginsburg just mentioned, it is explicit that a digital phono record delivery is each individual delivery of a phono record by digital transmission of a sound recording. And then later on, it talks about that without authorization of the copyright owner, let me just read the part of the language here. The owner of the copyright in the sound recording or the entity making the digital phono record delivery has obtained a compulsory license under this section or has otherwise been authorized by the copyright owner of the musical work to distribute or authorize the distribution by means of a digital photo record delivery of each musical work embodied in the sound recording. That is explicitly plain language. This notion that a digital file is not, when it's sent from point A to point B, is not a distribution, is just not supportable. And no court has ever recognized that, no court has ever said that. To say that when I buy something on iTunes and I buy the file and it is sent to me over the internet into my hard drive on my computer, that process is totally, the Copyright Act does not apply to that process, is just not, it just makes no sense. It absolutely makes no sense. And if you're talking about the plain language of the statute, I think section 115 talking about digital phono record delivery, you can't read that language out of the statute.
Thank you very much. And I think that, and I'm sure Mr. Bridges will have a response that I think I know where he's going to go with that and say, maybe reference other aspects of exclusive rights, perhaps. But I was going to follow up and say, you know, ask a question to the panelists in terms of the case law on this issue, whether there was any case law, in fact, suggesting that a download was not a distribution. And maybe Mr. Bridges, you had said, no, there isn't. Mr. Bridges, do you have any response to that?
A download is a reproduction. And why we have to double count, triple count acts under different distinct rights in order to essentially, I'm a trial lawyer. The reason people want to allege distribution right and not violation of the reproduction right is that they think that they can justify to a jury massive damages for distribution that sound egregious in the context of mere downloads, as in the case of Jamie Thomas Rassett, where they wanted to go after her for distribution to justify a $1.5 million jury verdict for 24 downloads. That's part of the rationale here. It's double counting to slip it into a more inflammatory sounding violation. Actually, 115, I believe, does not refer to distribution. The digital phono record delivery is not delivery of copies, it's delivery. It's distribution of works. Now, what distribution of works means, I'm not sure. But I know that section 106.3 is distribution of copies or phono records, which are material objects. And if somebody thinks that they're not material objects in section 101, I'd like to know what the legislative history is for that to vary from that text. Moreover, it's not just distribution of copies or phono records. It is by sale or other transfer of ownership or by rental, lease, or lending. Now, transfer of ownership means when person B gets it, person A, from person A no longer has it. What do you call it when person A has it and shares it with person B? You call that a reproduction.
Thank you. I'm going to go with Professor Manel and then Professor Ginsburg and then Mr. Borkowski. Although I will say we don't want to spend too much time on this particular topic because I will say, quite frankly, we thought it was fairly well settled, but it apparently is not quite as well settled as we thought. I'll go with first with Mr. Manel.
Well, I think it is completely settled, at least as far as judicial opinions. There are no decisions that come to the conclusion that Mr. Bridges refers to, and Judge Gertner's 2008 opinion, which he praises, is, I think, the clearest. In that case, the defendant's counsel and EFF made the very same argument that Mr. Bridges presents here. Rather than endorse that argument, Judge Gertner concludes unequivocally at page 173, quote, an electronic file transfer is plainly within the sort of transaction that Section 1063 was intended to reach, precisely because it does implicate, quote, a material object, and because it focuses on the result of that transaction, which is that there is a transfer. Now, I would say that Mr. Bridges' point is certainly a plausible point. You can make that argument. My article goes through how you sort of fit it in, and I say there is ambiguity here, and that's why I think the legislative history is useful. When you read Judge Gertner's opinion, she completely agrees with that. I mean, she goes through the legislative history, and I'll note, because Mr. Bridges in his filing says that I don't address this, I want to point him and the committee to, or the Copyright Office, to
it feels very formal in here today.
Section 8.11 D4AI of NIMR on copyright, which I co-authored, it so indicates, in which we, David NIMR and I, discuss Judge Gertner's opinion at length. And we make exactly the point that is alleged that I don't deal with. So it's set forth there. And I would just say that decision directly contradicts this point that Mr. Bridges is making. And I'm not going to say that his point isn't a plausible point. I'm going to say that it has been raised, it has been addressed, and in terms of where the state of the law is, the Judge Gertner's opinion is, I would say, the most thorough analysis that we have in a reported decision.
Thank you very much. I think Professor Ginsburg was next, then Mr. Borkowski and Mr. Bridges. Did you want to go again? Yeah. Oh, okay. You agree with what Professor Manel said. Mr. Borkowski?
Yeah, I just wanted to address a point about the distribution argument with Section 115 that Mr. Bridges made a moment ago. Section 115 is entitled Compulsory License for Making and Distributing Phono Records. It is a limitation on the Section 1063 distribution right. There would be no need, if a digital phono record delivery were not a distribution, there would be no need to limit that right through a compulsory license. There would be no need for a compulsory license because the right wouldn't exist. The text of the statute, I think, is plain. And on this or other transfer of ownership point that Mr. Bridges makes in his filing and also just now, the transfer of ownership is the transfer of ownership of the copy. It's quite simple. I mean, that's what it is.
Mr. Bridges, do you have any brief response to that?
Well, the point is, it is for the making and distributing of phono records, and the making, it seems evident. Two questions. Do we need multiple rights? Should a download also be a performance? Should a download also be a derivative work? Should we multiply violations for single acts? That's what's happening here. Is a copy the making of a phono record? Is the transfer of a file that lands on a target storage medium? Is that not a reproduction so that we need to expand distribution to cover it? And then to shoehorn it into this sale or other transfer of ownership? It's not needed, other than to come up with inflammatory reasons for large jury verdicts. And the last thing I'll say is Mr. Manel sort of keeps mentioning the Gertner opinion. I think the Gertner opinion is the best opinion out there. I don't think that any case has gotten it right. I hope that the right client will hire me to make the point in the right case, and that a judge will feel comfortable actually reaching what feels like, to a judge, a more radical outcome. But the more radical outcome absolutely comports with the statute. And if somebody has contrary evidence as to why 106.3 doesn't mean what it says, then I'd like to hear that.
And I think you have gotten some responses here today. I think because I do want to have a couple of other questions that further discuss the issues with respect to making available more broadly, I do want to get the last couple of questions that we have, last couple of responses that we have, rather, and then move on with another question. But I think that we had Mr. Brockowski, Mr. Schuber, and then Professor Ginsburg. And then I'll go on with the next question.
Thank you. I just, because he said it twice now, I can't leave this point unresponded to. But this notion that having a digital distribution right, which I think plainly exists, to argue that that is just some kind of way to gin up statutory damages or large jury verdicts against infringers, it just shows. Everybody knows the industry and the defendants usually that Mr. Bridges represents, and he does a fabulous job doing that. But that it is that those defendants who want to go out of their way to make it virtually impossible for copyright owners to protect their works. And if you do not have a digital distribution right, and if you don't have making available right, then you have to track down every single download. Or if you have an investigator who is an anti-piracy investigator who shows that a download has happened from an infringing site, and maybe he or she downloads 15 works, while, let's say, 2,000 are being offered up, please come here and take them for free, that is going to significantly negatively impact copyright owners in protecting their rights. There is massive, massive infringement on the internet, and every time, and we need more tools to combat it, not fewer tools.
Thank you, and we will get into some of the evidentiary questions, I think, a little bit later. I'm going to go with Matt Schur, and then Professor Ginsburg, and then John Beider. Did I get that right? Yes.
Okay. I don't want to weigh in on the debate about material copies, other than to say that, to some extent, the very informed exchanges here do somewhat conflate two separate questions, right? So material copies is one aspect of 106.3. And sale or other transfer of ownership is another question. So the sort of analytical framework requires satisfying these two elements. A lot of interesting sort of brain-twisting conversations about material copies, and I think that's very interesting. You need to satisfy that to get to a digital distribution right. You need to satisfy that and sale or other transfer of ownership, and by satisfy, I mean sort of wish it away, to get to making available. So even if we establish, and there's probably good policy reasons for that, that digital distribution is distribution under 106.3 because of material copies involves digital copies. That doesn't get us to a making available right. That only gets us halfway to digital distribution. Then you also need to sort of jump that second chasm to get to digital attempted distribution.
Right, and that is actually why I did want to not spend too much time on this early conversation, because there are two aspects of the discussion. Once you accept or not, or assume for purposes of our discussion that digital distribution is covered under Section 106, then you do have to get to the making available concept as well. But I think Professor Ginsburg was next.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. I think that one cannot say that Section 115 is only about making copies, because it says to make and distribute to the public. And if you're not going to distribute those copies, those phonorecords to the public, you don't get the compulsory license. But the point I wanted to make addresses a different proposition, which we may develop further. Andrew Bridges says that the a digital distribution right is simply an abusive add-on, and what's going on here is reproduction. Well, I think there's two answers. One is we could have a real making available right that stopped slicing and dicing everything, our current patchwork. I suspect that there's not that much enthusiasm for a real making available right, and that's another panel. But I think that it would be very problematic to limit the digital communication of files to a reproduction right in light of Cablevision. Because under Cablevision, who knows what's going to happen by the end of June, but in light of Cablevision, it's the user who is, quote, making the copies, so the reproduction is not occurring at the level of the entity that is offering those to the possibility to make those copies. A distribution right could actually fill the gap created by Cablevision, at least under the interpretation of Judge Gertner in the London Sire case. She says that causing that there is a transfer of ownership when the copy gets made in the recipient's file, but that happens because there's a distribution. So the act of distribution, at least as viewed by Judge Gertner, would identify an infringement at the level of the economic actor that is making, that is causing those copies to be made, even if one were to follow Cablevision and say that the reproduction is engaged in by the end user. So I think that the distribution right, far from being an abusive add-on, might be the only thing that saves us from non-compliance with our international obligations.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go to Mr. Bider and then Mr. Schur, but it looks like we do have now two final, hopefully, flags on this particular issue, because I do have a specific question that I do want to get to in terms of the aspect of making available. But if you want to go on to have some discussion in terms of the material object point and digital distribution, we'll have a final comments right now.
Well, I just want to say I'm not really here to focus on the distribution right because I'm here representing a performing rights organization, but just observing the conversation, it does seem to me that there is a certain amount of agreement that the language concerning the distribution right is unambiguous. It just appears that there's a lot of, not a lot of agreement on what it means. Therefore, the legislative
history
might be helpful.
It's unambiguous, but people don't agree about what it means. That's a... Thank you. I think it was Professor Manel next, and then Mr. Schur.
It's my understanding that we're going to talk this afternoon about policy issues, and a lot of what Mr. Bridges has said on this issue, at least in his most recent comments, I think go directly to those questions. This session, I understand, to be about what the law is,
right.
How it's interpreted. So I want to quote a brief passage from London Sire. Judge Gertner says, Congress wrote Section 106.3 to reach the, quote, unauthorized public distribution of copies or phone records that were lawfully made, citing the House report. That's certainly
unlawfully made,
thank you. That certainly includes situations where, as here, an original copy is read at point A and duplicated elsewhere at point B, footnote 28. It is irrelevant that such an action may also infringe the reproduction right secured to the copyright holder under Section 106.1. A single action can infringe more than one right held under Section 106. So the final sentence in this paragraph is, since the focus of 106.3 is the ability of the author to control the market, it is concerned with the ability of a transferor to create ownership in someone else, not the transferor's ability simultaneously to retain his own ownership. Now, that was an interpretation. I would acknowledge that we could have interpreted it differently, but if we're trying to address, as this session is, what courts have interpreted and how they've done it, they've used legislative history, and they've come to this interpretation.
Thank you. And I think we have Mr. Schur, or did you have a... Okay. Mr. Schur.
So following on Professor Ginsburg's comment earlier with respect to Cablevision, I think that's only correct if we assume that at no point do secondary liability doctrines enter into the conversation. And I mention that, one, because I fully expect that a lot of parties in future Cablevision-like scenarios will freely resort to secondary liability. And also because I think that that points out a very important aspect of this conversation, which is that our broad and often expanding secondary liability doctrines here in the United States are part of our international compliance, and so, I'm sorry, international treaty compliance. And so, you know, to the extent there are any gaps, I think one needs to allege not only is there a gap with some agreed upon international interpretation, but also that secondary liability does not apply in that gap. And seeing the frequency with which secondary liability theories are alleged, I'm not inclined to think there are many cases where plaintiffs wouldn't allege secondary liability. So, I'm just.
I think we are going to have a few questions about the secondary liability point and whether you should consider that as part of the kind of overall ability to satisfy the U.S. obligations under making available right, the concept of a secondary liability. But I wanted to turn back to the text of the statute in terms of focusing on the actual issue of whether, putting aside again, assuming for the moment that a digital download is a distribution, whether the act of making that download available to the public is a violation of our current law, which, as we have pointed out before, we have an obligation to, and the Congress, as well as the executive branch, has concluded that, in fact, our law does cover making available. But what some of the comments mentioned the phrase that is in Title 17 to authorize the distribution as an important aspect of the discussion as to whether there is a making available right in the United States. And so I wanted to just get some general thoughts as whether what is the role of the phrase to authorize in the opening clause of Section 106, and that it, is that important for the interpretation of the scope of the distribution right in the United States and how it relates to making available. Any takers on that? Mr. Shura?
If I could just, since this is relevant to my previous point, authorize is frequently pointed to, and without taking this position. Litigants often point to authorize as a statutory basis for theories of secondary liability, and indeed Commonwealth countries frequently use authorize in their articulation of secondary liability doctrines. So, you know, I think that's a perfectly good segue to demonstrate that secondary liability theories are going to be relevant here in the context of our compliance.
Thank you. Professor Ginsburg?
Whatever to authorize may have thought to have been meant when the 76 Act was drafted, I'm not sure that it's been interpreted in a way that is consistent with its interpretation in Commonwealth countries. It has been interpreted as secondary liability. And I think that it's quite problematic to base our compliance with a making available right on secondary liability, because it means that the end user is the first line infringer. And I don't think that we should base a copyright system on making end users the first line infringer.
Anisha, Mr. Bridges, and then Professor Minnell.
Right. I question that question that she just made, making end users the primary target, the primary infringer. That was the very issue in Cablevision. In Cablevision, it was not a question as to whether a reproduction had been made or not. The question was who made the reproduction, and the view was that Cablevision did not make the reproduction. It's what I call thumb-based liability. You're liable for direct infringement if your thumb on the remote control causes the copy to be made. That's the way the Second Circuit came out, and it, by stipulation, the court, the parties had taken fair use and secondary liability off the table. So it should not be seen as a question of whether there's a reproduction or not. Cablevision is about who made the reproduction. Now, it may be unpalatable to sue the individuals, and that takes us right back to the question of respect for copyright law. Because if individuals are going to be held liable, they may not like the state of the law. But the fact is, the individuals ought to be the first line of attack in terms of analyzing where the infringement occurs, whether it's wise to sue individuals or whether individuals have all sorts of fair use reasons for what they're doing is a separate matter. But saying, oh, we don't want to involve the public in this debate, I think avoids the real issues going on, because ultimately it's a public interest at stake. And the question is, are we just making intermediaries and technology companies the scapegoats for conduct that we really don't want the public to do?
And I think that we can explore some of those broader policy questions later in the afternoon and some of our conversations about clarity and then the possible benefits of clarity in our law. I think we had Professor Manel and then Professor Looney. Got it. And then Mr. Schur.
So the detailed answer to your question is that, like the term distribute, there is legislative history that tells us where the word authorize came from. But I would concur with Professor Ginsburg that this is not something that played much of a role in the development of the jurisprudence. And I think it's largely because until around 1998, 1999, until the internet really became the central focus, we were operating in a system in which the reproduction right did carry most of the power, that one could assert the reproduction right and win. And so once we got into a world where we had multiple layers of players, that's when this question of where is, as perhaps Judge Calabresi might say, you know, who's the least cost avoider? How can plaintiffs who are trying to protect their rights use the full panoply of rights? And I would agree that that is a hard question that has not been modernized, and I hope we will get to those issues later today. But in terms of how authorized developed, it kind of stagnated. We just didn't see that term being invoked. If you go outside of the United States, I think to Australia and some other countries, you'll see that that term did take on a broader meaning and might well provide something like a making available right. But it is, at least at this stage, a dormant issue.
Thank you. Mr. Lenny, and then Mr. Schur.
I just wanted to say that I agree with Professors Manel and Ginsburg on this, since I so rarely get the chance to say that.
Wonderful. We have one aspect of agreement on the panel today. That's great. Mr. Schur.
So I want to return to the question about end users being the first line of attack. It's certainly not desirable for end users to be the subject of litigation if the sort of file sharing, carpet bombing that the recording industry did, you know, back right after the millennium.
But I think that there's a suggestion that as the law should require that.
Ah, so that's where I'm going, right? I think making those parties the litigants is not the same as making those parties the infringers, right? And in the same way that, you know, Sony versus Universal didn't drag individual home recorders into the court, I think it's a foregone conclusion that the industrial actors are going to be the defendants most of the time, because that's where the money is, right? And so we don't need to sort of pretend those actors are the direct infringers simply because those are the ones who it's most palatable to sue. I think we simply acknowledge that you are suing the party who is secondarily liable for infringement that an end user is doing. It is one thing to say that the end user is the infringer, and another thing to say that the end user is the most desirable litigant. I don't think end users are desirable litigants for all the reasons that the Thomas Rosett case tells us. But that doesn't mean that we have to sort of disappear them from the whole process and then simply assume that the intermediary or the service provider or the device provider is now directly liable. Right. They would be secondarily liable to the extent that the end user is liable. And this simply, we dispute the issue, acknowledging that that party is relevant to the conversation, but also perhaps not the most desirable litigant. So it's very important to keep clear, you know, saying who is the direct infringer is not the same question as who do we want to drag into the courtroom.
But even for purposes of secondary liability, you would have to prove direct infringement, and so I think we're going to get into some, you know, questions with respect to how do you prove that in the context of someone who is, for example, uploading something on the internet. What, you know, how can you actually do that under our current law, and whether it is appropriately addressing that issue. I think we had Library of Congress next.
Never been called the Library of Congress. I just want to take this opportunity to mention one of several of my many unintended consequences remarks, and we talked about unauthorized copies, and I just want to remind, go on record as reminding people that libraries and archives have really no resources to track the historical acquisition histories of materials, and that there are many, probably many, many unauthorized copies in the collections of libraries and archives, including the Library of Congress. In my area, the Motion Picture Broadcasting and Recorded Sound Division, some of the most historically significant, important films, television broadcasts, sound recordings, radio broadcasts have come from private collectors and citizen donors to the collection. And these are materials that I can tell you most frequently, the rights holders, whether they're the creators, the heirs, or the members of the industry, don't hold physical copies of. So our role to acquire and preserve and sustain those stands to benefit all of those people significantly, and we're concerned about that.
Thank you. I think we'll have Mr. Bridges, and then Professor Looney, and then Professor Ginsburg.
One detail on the question of to authorize, and I didn't research this thing about it for today, but I think there's at least one case where a plaintiff sued a defendant for licensing a work that the defendant did not have the rights to license. And I think it was a lawsuit under the authorize prong, and I think that the court decided that the mere granting of a license did not violate the authorized prong, that the actual exploitation of a Section 106 right had to have occurred in order for the violation, for the plaintiff to have a violation here. So I think using to authorize as a wedge to try to get at offers or inchoate action that doesn't actually result in an actual exploitation of a Section 106 right probably would not fly under current law. Others made no contrary decisions, but I do recall one decision to this effect.
And I think that's mentioned in, I think, Tom Sidner's comments, I believe. Professor Lunny, and then Professor Ginsburg.
I just wanted to respond briefly to Matthew's point about having the direct infringers, the consumers, be the direct infringers just as a convenient backdrop. I think we got into a lot of trouble by using them that way, and Napster, the Ninth Circuit sort of casually brushes aside the direct infringement question, casually brands everyone an infringer because they're not before the court. And then when it gets turned around in 2003 and they start suing individual file sharers, I think it's a problem. I would much rather have a system that's rational with respect to the people who can control the infringement than going after the consumers just as a hook to get those parties involved. Now, it may be some of the secondary liability standards with the sort of knowledge and other aspects of it that make it not so much a strict liability tort, are better tailored to address the copyright infringement issues in this context. But I think it's extremely problematic to have those consumers on the hook as direct infringers as a necessary sort of predicate for the secondary liability standard.
Thank you, Professor Ginsburg.
I will return the favor and say that that I also agree with the desirability of going after the economic actor and not the end user, not only as a matter of litigation, but even in terms of how we want to conceptualize the system. But this comment goes to basing enforcement on secondary liability actually work? And I think there's a significant problem with that, because again, assuming that the Cablevision model remains viable, so that the end user makes the copy. Let's suppose the storage locker is sitting on a server outside the United States, right? So the copy, where's the copy made? Is it made in Vanuatu? And at that point, there could be a violation of Vanuatan copyright law, but under U.S. precedent, notably the Subba Films case, there's no secondary liability under the U.S. copyright law for enabling an infringement outside of the United States. So that would then get one into the question, whether, first of all, is there a violation of the copyright law where the server is perhaps opportunistically located? And that may be certainly raise litigation costs in trying to figure out what pleading and proving foreign law. And then there's the problem that in lots and lots of countries, they don't have secondary liability the way we do. So this could actually be rather clever scheme to insulate a digital delivery business model.
Thank you. Mr. Bridges?
Thank you. I wanted to go back to the issue of individuals versus the economic actors. I think that the recording industry made a very, very fundamental mistake when it went after Napster, because there were people who believed that it was okay to download things, it was just not okay to be Napster. And by not bringing enforcement against individuals, the enforcement did not bring home to the public that they have a responsibility and they have obligations under the law. And I remember, I think it was at a hearing in the Senate, I think Senator Schumer, if I'm correct, was saying that his daughter was downloading music from Napster while it was still legal, was his phrase. He didn't stop to think that his daughter was doing anything wrong. He just thought that Napster was okay until the court said it wasn't okay, but that the only question was about Napster's conduct. So I do think that putting the public front and center enforcement, I completely agree. I don't think that it's wise to go out and sue lots of members of the public. But that brings me to my second point. A good reason to put the public front and center is it's sort of like how the society feels about wars, maybe when there's a draft instead of a volunteer army. And when people think that their sons and daughters may get sent off to war, they might feel a little bit differently about going into war. If the public thinks that, if the public thinks we're going to get sued and we're going to be held liable for a $1.5 million jury verdict for 24 downloads, what do we think about this system? And I think actually keeping the focus on the public will help provoke the public debate that is so necessary in this arena.
I see a lot of raised flags in response to that, so I think we have a lot of discussion. Because Mr. Brockowski can respond to this first, because I think some of this is putting perhaps some of the content owners in somewhat of a catch-22, because on the one hand you say, well, we shouldn't have these $1.5 million statutory damage awards against users, but on the other hand, they should go after the users. But on the other hand, it's not a wise thing for them to do. So, Mr. Brockowski, do you have any response to that?
I do. This is an argument for essentially eliminating copyright protection completely, because what Mr. Bridges is arguing is, you know, you don't focus on the facilitators of the infringement. What you do is you have to focus and make people take public take responsibility for their actions. Nobody really believes that. The whole notion is that, you know, if you go after individuals, then all of a sudden there's going to be this huge groundswell of protest. And where this argument goes is that, therefore, we're going to water down the Copyright Act even more to prevent true enforcement of infringement. You have to go after the facilitators. The facilitators are the ones that cause the problems. The Napsters of the world, I litigated that case proudly on behalf of the record industry. The Napsters of the world are the problem. They are the facilitators. And you have to go after the facilitators. This is why the Supreme Court unanimously in the Grokster case pulled out this notion of inducement, which may or may not be part of contributory infringement. Who knows? I always plead it as a third cause of action, separate from contributory infringement. It is these actors who are inducing others to infringe, and they are responsible. They are clearly responsible. You could say that the individual is responsible. Sure, okay, morally, let's say. But there's that doesn't mean that the intermediary is not also responsible. And it is these doctrines of secondary liability, which are extremely important and do allow us to go after those who are really creating the problem of copyright infringement on the internet.
Okay, thank you very much. And I think we're going to go to Professor Minnell, then Mr. Schreuer, then back to Mr. Bridges, although I will want to turn it back again to the making available concept, because I think we are talking a lot about a lot of very broad general concepts in terms of secondary liability, who should we sue users or statutory damages too high. And I do want to make sure that we focus on the issue of making available. And so we're going to have some specific questions in terms of under our law, what are particular activity does violate Title 17. But first we'll go to Professor Monell.
I do think that we're again bleeding into what is the ultimate policy choices, and you know, I'm very anxious to talk about that, but I feel that would be jumping the gun. The one point that I'll make right now is that I'm feeling deja vu. In April 2002, I moderated a panel at the Computers, Freedom, and Privacy, underline privacy conference, that took place in San Francisco, and a member of a senior attorney at EFF made exactly the point that Andrew's making, although he was perhaps even more aggressive in saying that you're targeting the wrong people. And we've recently relived that because I relate that story in an article, and it was disputed whether or not it was said. We got the transcript, it was said. But I do think that we are in this sort of very delicate space where we can easily make arguments on either side of how we should go forward. And as my comments do discuss, we are, I think, largely talking about issues of remedy. I mean, remedy is what's driving so much of this, that if we had sensible remedies, I think the making available issue is, I'll use a term of art, a no-brainer. I don't think we really want to get into debates over whether someone should be able to put a recently released film into a folder that's available to the public at large. And that relates to something that Professor Lenny also raises in his comments, on which I would agree with him, that the porn troll litigation that's going on is, I think, very counterproductive to the entire copyright system. And one of the advantages of having a clear making available right is that we don't even get into the joinder question, because it means that every member of the BitTorrent swarm is him or herself liable under 106.3. And that would modestly improve what is, I think, a very pathological part of our copyright system right now. And I would hope that everyone on a panel like this would say that was not what the founders or the drafters of the 76 Act or anyone thought the copyright system should be about, trying to use the threat of exposing someone's private viewing habits as a basis for extorting a large settlement. And so the making available right actually does clarify and clean up that kind of litigation. But I think we ought to step back and try to rationalize more than just making available in order to get past this roadblock.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go to Mr. Schurer and then Mr. Bridges, but I'm going to preview my next question about the making available right, which is to have some focus in the discussion in terms of, okay, we're assuming for purposes of our discussion that digital download is a violation of the distribution right, but we want to now take it a step further in terms of making available. And the question will be to the panel, how, first of all, just a very broad, how do we implement the making available right in the United States generally and to focus on? And then I'm going to have some specific questions in terms of particular activity. But I will start now with Mr. Schurer and Mr. Bridges to close off this aspect of the discussion that we have right now.
So going back to what Andrew said before and his sort of draft analogy, I do think there is something important to take away from the observation that it's easier to have an utterly ridiculous copyright system so long as it stays below the radar, right? As long as nobody notices how ridiculous it is, we don't really have to worry about that, right? And you know, sort of lawyers, we can rationalize it. It's hard to rationalize things to the public. And so if you're sort of, you know, are afraid to have airing the litigation laundry, then maybe we need to think about, you know, how well the system's functioning. But I also want to focus on the like targeting the right people, and I think the word target or attack or go after, these are all very ambiguous. The point is
sue maybe for infringement.
Right. So I think sue is the best verb to use. There are a lot of reasons we've seen why plaintiffs want to sue the intermediaries, the service providers, the device manufacturers, whatever. That's fine. You are the author of your complaint. You can sue whom you see fit. But my point is that just because it makes sense from a pecuniary standpoint and from a litigation convenience standpoint to go after the device manufacturer, the service provider, so on. That doesn't mean that you can now pretend that that actor is the direct infringer. Right? They may well, under once a burden of proof has been met, be established to be a secondarily liable actor, and many remedies still apply against that actor. But to the extent there's any merit in the argument that we don't want to be dragging end users into the courtroom, doesn't mean you can wish the end user away. The end user is a party to the transaction, and proof of direct infringement by the end user will be an element of the burden of proof against the intermediary. Because once we start using theories such as making available to transform those who were previously secondarily liable into direct infringers, you've very much upset existing balances in the statute, and now you may well have transferred an entire third tier of tertiary liable parties into secondarily liable parties. And I don't think we've fully explored the consequences of that.
Thank you, Mr. Bridges. Do you have a brief comment?
Very brief. I am pleased to be able to agree with Professor Monell. And this is a little bit on a tangent, but I think it's important to say it here. He said that the remedy issues are really driving a lot of the discussion. Let me be clear. I think statutory damages are the single most distorting and corrupting aspect of copyright law that should be amended today. And then when that gets fixed, I actually think then is the time to see what other changes to make in copyright law. But the discussion is so distorted, I have yet, in the last decade, I have not defended a single case where the damages claimed were less than $1 billion. And my current case right now, over 30,000 photographs of a softcore porn company, the claim is $4.5 billion. The LimeWire case, Judge Wood pointed out that the plaintiffs were seeking trillions of dollars more money, by quoting approvingly the defendant's brief, than the entire revenues of the recording industry since Thomas Edison invented the phonograph. When that gets fixed, a lot of the other discussions here can be put into a different light.
And that's, I think, some of the discussion we'll discuss a little bit later in terms of benefits of clarity and how that might look. But we don't want to have a specific discussion exclusively about statutory damages. So I want to go back to the question that I previewed in terms of going back to making available. How does the United States implement the making available right in its law? We talked a little bit earlier about legislative history and the fact that legislative history, or at least some of the recent legislative history that was uncovered, suggests that Congress did in fact intend to very clearly cover a making available right. We talked about the fact that publication was very broad under the 1909 Act, and distribution was simply seen in some people's views as synonymous with publication or to publish. And then we discussed briefly whether to authorize would be another hook to talk about the act of making available under the United States law. So I wanted to broadly have the question about U.S. law, how do we implement the making available right? And then I want to go through just a couple of brief examples of particular conduct. For example, the act of a person simply putting a digital file in their shared folder on their computer. Is that the act of making available, and does that violate in and of itself U.S. law? So I'll start with Professor Ginsburg.
I think we might need to start by seeing if we all understand what making available is in the same way, because as I read the comments, I think that there might not be full agreement.
That's a very good question, actually, because, and we might discuss this more a little bit in later on when we talk about internet, how different countries have implemented it, but it seems like there was a large consensus that yes, we do have a making available right, but then different people disagreed as to whether that right, for example, would cover the activity of just offering something for sale.
Exactly.
Offering a download.
So I believe that the making available right covers not only the actual transmission or delivery, but also the offering. Whether it's offering a download or offering a stream, that the standard in the WIPO copyright treaties, so is clear in that respect, but I think we'll probably defer that issue to the last panel. But if one starts from the position that the making available right includes not merely actual delivery communications of downloads or streams, but offers to download or stream, then the next question is, was Congress right in saying that under the so-called umbrella solution, we actually had a sufficient patchwork of rights? And that in turn requires an understanding of both the public performance right as covering the offering or the proposal to communicate a performance or a display of the work, and also of the distribution right as covering the offer to distribute. So in that respect, I agree that the steps there, the question is whether, as a matter of positive law, we've filled in all those steps. And I think that the cases on the digital distribution right are a little all over the map. So while the PTO green paper says somewhat hopefully, perhaps, that our positive law does recognize a digital distribution right, I suppose.
And we have said that as well.
Right. Okay. Excuse me. And the Copyright Office has also said that. I suppose there's some room for doubt, although I agree with Professor Minnell that the better interpretation that would reach both the actual distribution of a file and the offer to distribute a file. I had thought that at least on the public performance right side, we were in compliance. But as a result of Cablevision and Aereo, I'm less confident of that conclusion because of the nifty trick of turning everything into a private performance by virtue of an intermediate consumer-made copy that is the source of the communication. So I suppose that it is possible to interpret the extant copyright law in a way that would cover what I think is the full scope of the making available right. But I think that there are divergent in interpretations, and so it would be necessary to have a consistent interpretation. On your question about putting a file in a shared folder, I think that if the sharees are sufficiently numerous, they are a substantial number of persons beyond a family and its circle of social acquaintance, then I think that would be a making available to the public.
And just to follow up really quickly before I turn it over to the others, you mentioned that, you know, if interpreted correctly, our law, you know, our extant rights would cover making available. And could you just explain in terms of how the law would work in that regard, if it is in fact interpreted in that way, and whether there are courts that have so found that with respect to the current state of our law?
So I think that Judge Gertner's decision comes closest on the distribution rights side through the evidentiary device of presuming that an actual transmission or an actual distribution has taken place. But I don't think it should be necessary to do that. The Elektra case, by going with the publication right, and I defer to Peter on this, maybe comes closest. Although I suppose there's not complete agreement on publication. And with respect to the public performance right, I think that the language of the definition of public performance is actually quite close to the formulation of the making available right. The principal problem, I think, is not necessarily doctrinal. I mean, I think that the bits and pieces are there, but it's rather one that a couple of people have alluded to, which is right now the way the business slices up the rights runs the risk of having to get multiple clearances, and that doesn't seem desirable. Now, some of this may be slowly being worked out, but it would be an advantage of a making available right is that it would sort of force a simplified clearance process. But whether, even if we remain with the current patchwork, I think it will be necessary to find ways to not make people pay more than once. The last thing I would say with in that respect, considering the patchwork and also who owns which rights, is that we have thought that we could tell the difference between a download and a stream. We could tell the difference between a reproduction distribution on the one hand and a public performance on the other hand. That's the Ringtones case. But I think that the court there was looking at two ends of the spectrum when they invoked the metaphor of the record store for a download and the radio for a stream. That ignores that there may be a whole lot of activity in between those extremes whose characterization as a public performance or as a distribution, as a digital distribution of a copy or a phono record may not be so obvious. And that again raises the question of are we going to be making people pay twice for what economically should be a single operation?
Thank you very much. I'm going to go with Professor Manel, then Professor Looney, then Mr. Bridges, and then Lunny. Why do I want to keep doing that? Professor Lunny, then Mr. Bridges, and then Ms. Wolf. So, Professor Manel.
The question you ask is one that I think is built into it is how courts have gone about this process of adjudicating these different skirmishes. And if you look across all of those, there are these waves and patterns. And I think that's why many of the comments reflected a degree of, everyone was clear, as my fellow panelists said, on the statute being clear. It just, they disagreed on what it meant. And that's because, district judges are not experts in copyright law. They rely almost entirely upon the briefs that lawyers file in the cases, that the clerks are typically not trained at the sort of level of research that would have to go into the archaeology of 1960s legislation. And so what you get depends on, whether that judge has a particular approach to reading a statute or the amount that's put into the briefs. What shocked me when I went back and when I started this research, I pulled the briefs in every single case that adjudicated the distribution right in a file sharing context. And none of them found any of these materials that I found. And it surprised me in part because I would have expected the record companies and some of the motion picture studios who were paying very top law firms to find, the answers to these questions, I would have expected them to do this. And what I learned, and this is, I think, sort of true across a lot of area of copyright, is that people often stop at the House report. And if the House report doesn't, I'm talking about the House report that issued at the final legislative term where the law issued, if it doesn't have much on it, you don't see that in the briefs. Well, I believe that when courts start to look at this richer trove of material, they will come to a coherent analysis. I think Professor Ginsburg has woven it together. I think Judge Gertner did an amazing job, given that she didn't have all of that information. The one case that did was the 10th Circuit Diversey case. That's the only case that has confronted this issue at an appellate level since at least my research was available. And I don't know that the court fully read and agreed with everything. It cites that work, and in my work with David Nimmer, I think we try to come to a coherent analysis that is faithful to what Congress was trying to do and the passage of time and development of technology. Congress can put a finer point on this right now. I mean, this is, I think, worthwhile given that we have a lot of money being spent litigating cases, and I have no doubt that there will be further skirmishes. So the answer to I just don't put a lot of faith in decisions, even Judge Gertner's decision, just because she didn't have the evidence. So when you don't have good evidence, you don't often get the correct answers. I do believe that courts like this evidence. Not everyone, Justice Scalia probably being the extreme example, wouldn't look at it, but most judges, I think, do care about trying to be faithful to this institution. And, you know, when I think about how Congress in the 1960s would look at this issue, I think they would find this to be, as I said earlier, a no-brainer, that making a file available to the public at large. So let's just take one term from the 1909 Act, to vend. That was an express right. So do you think that if a bookseller had unauthorized, illegal copies of a book in the window with a price tag on it, that an investigator would have to photograph someone actually purchasing the book, or they would have to go and get evidence of someone who bought a book? No, I think that you would bring a lawsuit, you'd say they're vending it. Just as today, I think we could talk about putting it in a file share folder is making it available to the public, which is the concept of publication. Publication doesn't require a reception. And so we're just trying to kind of come to common sense approaches. What makes it not common sense is what Andrew and I do agree on, which is that I think the remedies are also out of step. But we can talk about that later. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go to Professor Lunny.
Thank you. So I wanted to start where Jane started, and that is we really don't know what the treaties require, right? So we have language from the treaties, but we have no authoritative source interpreting it. And so when she made certain statements in her comments about this is what the right means, I was curious to know what she would cite. And of course, she goes to the Court of Justice for the European Union, some other states that have implemented, but they're not binding. Their interpretations are not binding on us. And certainly in those states where it's been adopted, it's been inconsistently applied. There's at least some decisions, as she's acknowledged, that come out the same way as Cablevision under the making available language. So when I look at our law, and particularly the P2P file sharing context, or file sharing more generally today, the difference in litigation between having to prove a download and not having to prove a download is relatively small. If you see a file listed in a share folder, how do you know it's really that file? Not everything on the internet is what it says it is. That may surprise you. But you actually have to download it. And then when the investigator has downloaded it, that often, at least in the court's opinions, the litigators have argued this, but the courts have come out and said that's enough to show the download. So as a practical matter, that sort of minor technical difference in the evidentiary requirement seems to me is not going to put us out of step. Whether we require proof of download or don't, as part of the prima facie case, it's still going to be an element you're going to have to show to prove that it was, in fact, the work that you're claiming it was that was made available. So it seems impossible to me that that would put us out of step with our treaty obligations. And so that's where I want to start.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go to Mr. Bridges now.
Thank you. I want to criticize a casual shorthand paraphrase approach to copyright law. Our Copyright Act is like the Internal Revenue Code. And you could say we're going to tax acquisitions at such and such a rate. And you can have this general concept of acquisition, or you can distinguish between a sale of assets and a reverse triangular merger and all sorts of gymnastics that corporate lawyers do so well to guide themselves through the tax code to minimize taxes. There's no distribution right in American law. There's a distribution right of distributing copies or phonorecords to the public by sale or other transfer of ownership. That's the right. It's the right to distribute certain things in certain types of transactions. Now that we've been talking about the making available right, the making available right we've heard referred to a number of times. I disagree with Professor Lunny and Professor Ginsburg about whether it's clear as to what the making available right is. Let me read to you from the WIPO Copyright Treaty, Article 6. It's the making available to the public of the original or copies of works through sale or other transfer of ownership. That's not just making available disembodied from these particular aspects. And the agreed statement to Article 6 of that provision of the quote-unquote making available right explains that the term copies that are subject to that making available right refers exclusively to fixed copies that can be put into circulation as tangible objects. So now there's another form of making available that comes in under the right of communication, and that's different. That corresponds to our performance and display rights. But when we talk about the making available right, let's use the very, very terms that the treaty has if we mean to be referring to the right that the treaty describes.
Thank you very much. And I will just point, we referenced, for example, and Professor Ginsburg might have some response on this as well, WCT Article 8, because we were actually talking about the on-demand interactive context in the digital context. So.
Right. And I'm dividing up the distribution and performance prongs. Distribution corresponds to Article 6, and performance corresponds to Article 8. So we're coming back to the 106.3. That's Article 6.
Okay. I'm going to turn to Ms. Wolf next.
Sort of a segue, because the aspect I was interested in is the communication right, in particular the right of display, because I think if you're looking at that right, and if you look at, you know, the 106 rights, that we do have the right to publicly display works, but I think the courts have misinterpreted, and they have done what Andrew Bridges just said. You know, we should be separating out distribution from display. The courts, unfortunately, have tied reproduction to display. And I think they have misinterpreted the display rights such that visual artists really don't have a making available right with works once they're online. And I think it started with the Perfect 10 versus Amazon case, where they limited the process in which you communicate a visual work to one in which it's served on that particular server. So this, I think the server test, unfortunately, couples the reproduction right with the display right. And I think that too narrowly interprets the right of display, which deals with the right to transmit or otherwise communicate the display of the work to the public by means of any device or process. So what happens is, if you use clever technology devices, you can essentially cut and paste an image and do inline linking or framing, and so that the end user, the one who's viewing the communication, just sees a very, now even a large res image, high res image, which doesn't even now relate back to the original site where it came from. So by not having it on the server, there's no actual copying, so you never have any direct infringement. And unfortunately, it creates the actors who are making available images, and in many cases now, not even the thumbnails that were in the Perfect 10 case, but high-res, large images to the public, and it is causing very decreased traffic to the site, which has legally authorized the display of the image, and has a very high increase in piracy when it's very easy just to, right-click a high-res image. So that's where I think that the courts have really taken some missteps in looking at the display right and requiring it that there has to be a copy on a server of the direct infringer.
Thank you very much. And I'm just going to say that we have about 10, 15 minutes left. We did want to get an opportunity to see if there were any audience questions or comments, rather. So I'm going to really just end with the last number of flags that we have up, and then we'll turn it to the audience in case anybody from the audience has some remarks that they would like to make in response to any of the questions we raised in the first panel. I'm going to go to Mr. Barkowski first.
Thanks. I'll try to be brief. Just a couple of points I wanted to make, since we're talking about, you know, the language of whether it's the treaties or whether it's the or the Copyright Act. Putting aside legislative history, Section 506A1C of the Copyright Act imposes criminal penalties for the distribution of a work being prepared for commercial distribution by making it available on a computer network accessible to members of the public. That could not be clearer. The Copyright Act already recognizes making available explicitly. And also, if you look at the definition, I said this at the very beginning of this panel, the definition of publication under Section 101 of the Copyright Act, publication is the offering to distribute copies or phonorecords. And then publication is further defined as the distribution of copies or phonorecords. So the offering to distribute is already recognized by the Copyright Act. I think it is clear that if an online user puts something in his or her share folder, that volitional act is enough to be making available, whether whether she deliberately enables it or does not change the default to that is usually to share, which is usually what the intermediary secondary infringers try to get people to do. I'm just going to wait. This isn't directly relevant. I'll be 1 minute. I have to say that I do disagree with Mr. Bridges and even Professor Minnell. Statutory damages are one of the most important tools that copyright owners have. They have a deterrent effect, and they're critical to enable us to fight large scale online piracy. The Rasser Thomas case is always used as this example of, oh my God, look what happened. Well, three separate juries of her peers found her liable for lots and lots of money. Talk about individual responsibility. A jury of her peers, three separate times. I just want to make that crystal clear. So by the way, the amount that was awarded per infringement was substantially less than $150,000. I am not aware of any large-scale infringement case in which any jury has come close to awarding the maximum. So whatever is, as Andrew said, whatever is pled in complaints by plaintiff's lawyers, you know, billions of dollars, Dr. Evil, whatever, it's not realistic. The awards are nowhere nearly close to the maximum. All right.
I'm going to go to Mr. Schur, Mr. Diana, Professor Ginsburg, and then in with Mr. Bider. Thank you.
So regarding the language in Section 506 that Mr. Borkowski quoted, I think that's actually a limitation on the language, right? It is one particular modality by which it might be distributed. That doesn't mean that modality satisfies the distribution, right? So, you know, if it had said distributing it by throwing it out of an airplane, that wouldn't mean that every time somebody threw something out of an airplane that violated the distribution, right? I mean, you'd still have to satisfy all the other elements. In fact, I think that's dispositive in the other direction. It shows that when Congress wants to say making available, they say making available. If you look in Chapter 9 regarding semiconductors, when referring to distribute, we do define distribute there to include distribution or offers to distribute. So it's, you know, the language is pretty clear when it needs to be. Ultimately, I think what some of the previous commenters indicated is this is just about litigation burden, and the allegation that it might be harder to prove actual distribution than it is to prove making available. And yet, some of the end user cases that we're looking at, making available is viewed in some of these cases as sufficient evidence to satisfy a civil liability burden that distribution actually happened. So, you know, ultimately, the use of all of this legislative history, which we don't actually know the parties didn't find. All we know is that they didn't find it or they didn't see fit to cite it, right? To come to an outcome that's supposed to make an alleged evidentiary burden more convenient, I don't think it's very persuasive. If we're going to say that, if we're going to go pointing to places where the evidentiary burden is outside some acceptable standard deviation, you know, I think you can just as easily make the same case about statutory damages. In statutory damages, the evidentiary burden is very easy. One is required to make no evidence of injury. So, you know, given that hasn't been provided sufficient motivation to change statutory damages, I don't see why an allegedly elevated burden on the allegation of in the cause of action with respect to just actual distribution is that onerous, or at least so onerous as to require a change.
Thank you very much. And we'll, I think, get a chance to explore those in a little bit more detail in the next panel, which addresses some of these same issues, because we didn't get a chance to explore those issues fully in this panel. I'm going to go next to Mr. Diana.
Thanks. I just want to quickly note that in the case of the diversity, a library was found to have infringed by simply cataloging this item that was in their collections. And if that, in fact, is something that's going to hold or continue, the impact on what we do, that is preserve things for the future, sustain them while they're in copyright and beyond their copyright protections, is very much at risk. Because the cataloging process The documenting of these items in a catalog system is an absolutely essential step prior to digitizing these materials in libraries and archives for preservation. You take that out and you've chilled the whole act of preservation, and you have a collection of analog materials deteriorating. And I will say that a lot of these issues will continue to into the digital realm as materials are produced and distributed, I shouldn't even say that, digitally, that libraries and archives will continue to have these collections there that are no longer marketplace items that they need to sustain. And so being able to catalog them and have metadata on them is an essential aspect of what we do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll go to Professor Ginsberg next, and then Mr. Bider, and then we'll end with Mr. Manel, actually, because he did have his, and then we'll, if there are no audience participants, I'll go with to Professor Loney. Okay.
I think Nancy made an important point about another gap in the positive law, that it's not clear that the display right, which is part of the making available right, is fully covered by virtue of decisions like Perfect 10. And this gets into a topic which perhaps you had intended to raise as a concrete example and was addressed by a number of the comments, which is linking a making available. And the international panel, we can talk about the EU's ECJ's recent decision. I want to advert particularly to the comments of the Digital Public Library of America, because it is absolutely true that linking is a very important function within the library context, very important public benefits. Does it follow that if linking were to be considered a form of making available, that would be the end of libraries and so forth? And I think not, because we have Section 512D, and I don't think any of the comments referred to Section 512D, which states that a service provider, which that term has been interpreted so extremely broadly in the case law, that I think it would pretty clearly cover a library. A service provider shall not be liable for monetary relief or except as provided for injunctive or other equitable relief for infringement of copyright, so distribution right, display right, excuse me, by reason of the provider referring or linking users to an online location containing infringing material or infringing activity by using information location tools, including ... hypertext link, if the service provider and then complies with the notice and takedown provisions. So I think that if one were to say that at least certain kinds of linking, such as the framing that occurred in the Perfect 10 case, was a form of making available, that I think is not necessarily a problem, because that's what Section 512D is for.
Thank you very much. I'm going to actually have to close it with Mr. Bider, so that everybody I saw earlier, and then I'm going to open it up to the audience for a few minutes if they have any final responses to some of our questions. If you do, please line up now at the podium, and then we'll have about 5 minutes of audience remarks, and if we have any time, which I doubt we will do, we will go back to any participants that I wasn't able to call on, and obviously in the next panel we'll be able to continue our exploration of this issue. Mr. Bider?
Well, speaking now specifically about the public performance right, I think we are in agreement that Congress did express the idea that it believed that the rights then extant in the copyright statute were sufficiently broad to encompass the making available right. Unfortunately, from the public performance standpoint, the courts have since interpreted that right more narrowly. Generally, it involves decisions that are not technologically neutral, going back to the ASCAP AOL decision in the rate court, where there was a bright line set between downloads, which are distributions, and streaming, which is public performance. although that may stand as precedent, as my son informs me, that technology has overtaken that decision and that there is contemporaneous ability to listen as you download, as we all know now. And then the more recent Cablevision and Aerial cases, again, not technologically neutral, which I believe is a hallmark of the WIPO treaties when it comes to making available ride. The focus again being on the technology by which the end user avails him or herself of the work, and determining that one transmission, each transmission being private, even though there be maybe multiple transmissions and an entire business model built upon multiple transmissions. So from CSAC's perspective, the public performance right has been narrowed, and the question of whether it still encompasses its share of the making available right under the treaties is in question. One other thing I wanted to say, the terminology in the panel and the papers today, there's been reference to end users and I think alternatively to consumers. And I just, you know, words are important, and I think definitions are important, and I think my sense, as a non-legalistic sense, a consumer is somebody in my mind who pays for something, pays for the end product, pays for the service, and although these end users, not all of these end users may be consumers, and I don't think, and I think there's a certain patina of legitimacy and benevolence in being a consumer, and I don't think that that is necessarily to be applied to all end users.
Thank you very much. And I want to thank all of the participants. We actually are a little bit over time as well, so I don't think we have any time to go back to any of the participants, but we will have an audience session at the end of the day in which we can explore these issues further. Do we have anybody from the audience who wants to make remarks in response to anything that was raised? All right, we'll have a very, very short 15-minute break and come back at 11 o'clock with our next session. Thank you very much.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.